Welcome to Bunnyfish Crafts. I'm your host, Heather, known as Bunnyfish on Ravelry, Instagram, and YouTube. Today is Monday, the 10th of November, 2014, and this is episode 103, Tradesies. Grab some sticks and string and come sit with me. There's 1 week left before I draw for the Potiversary prizes, so less than a week by the time this goes up. Get over there, make your choices, have your conversational piece. I've really enjoyed all the posting that's gone on in that thread. So thank you so much for that. I am highly distractible today, so I'll try not to be too distracted. I have two finished objects, and they're very small, and you did not see them last week. But I'm going to talk about them later and instead show you works in progress. Worked on my mom's super bright sweater. It is past splitting for the sleeves. So there are sleeves and she likes it, so that's the important thing. I still think it's way super bright. I'm going to try it on for you so you can see. So this is kind of what it'll look like. It's not quite fitting properly because I'm not closing it in the front. It will close all the way in the front, but I'm not wearing needles big enough around the bottom for that. So super bright. My mom loves it though. She said, okay, my sister and I were very not nice. Our mom has what my sister refers to as the ugly dress collection. I would say that my mom's like her everyday wear, her jeans and t-shirts are fine and normal, but her dress collection is kind of like the 60s, 70s, and 80s got married and had a lot of children, and those children are her dresses. So they're a lot of look. And some of them I think are fine, and some of them I think are a little bit like this sweater. But she said she would wear the sweater with her entire ugly dress collection. So, we're such mean daughters. Oh well. I'm sure that Mara will say similar things when she is older than 4 and can have an opinion. Because right now, everything I wear is awesome, she thinks. I am making this sweater out of Red Heart Super Saver in Black Light. This is the second skein of yarn. I have 4. I'm not sure if I'm going to need 5. Trying to guess, but I'm still pretty new at this whole sweater thing. So judging how much yarn I need for it is kind of tricky. I guess it wouldn't be the worst thing ever to have this yarn, a skein of this yarn in my stash after I finish my mom's sweater, because it would make cool monsters and stuff. Cool kids things. I just, as a garment, I don't know. But I love my mom, and she wanted a super bright sweater. I will show you my progress right after I put that stitch marker in, because I was talking, so I started knitting. So this is where I was last week on the podcast, and this is what I finished that day. And this is each day's progress is marked by a different stitch marker. I could move this project along more quickly, but I am trying to pace myself for the point of Nanosuemo. I'm trying deliberately to not just finish the sweater in 2 weeks, which I easily could. So I'm doing approximately the 1,667 stitches. I don't stop before I reach that point, but So some days I'm at like 19 or 1800 because I have to finish the sets of rows. So the knit row and then the purl back row. But it's always around the amount for the day. And I'm making up the pattern as I go, just like I did for Amanda's sweater. Made up the hood. I'm kind of using the increases, the raglan increases from $5 in Paris, which is a free Ravelry pattern, but I'm doing it as a cardigan instead of a pullover. And I will most likely use the pockets from the, I don't know, it's that Nitty sweater that I use the pockets for on Amanda's sweater. I want to say Armandine or something. I don't remember. It's a yellow sweater that was from last year's Deep Fall Nitty. Other works in progress. I am sure that I worked on Kenny's socks a little, but not much. I think I was almost finished with the toe last week, so yeah. I just haven't been working on that because my mom's sweater is all stockinette. Even though it has pearl back rows, it's still all stockinette. And right now, these socks are all stockinette. I started a new project, which is pretty awesome. And it's not for me, and I wish it was. And I consider making myself a pair, but realistically, that's not going to happen because then I would have to make myself something. So what I am making is a pair of mittens for my sister. And can you read that? It's such kind of awkward trying to turn my wrist that way for you. I don't know why, it just is. It says T-O-T-O-R-O. I'm making her Totoro mittens. This will be the top of the mitten, and this will be the bottom. So the pattern is Brella's Norwegian Totoro mittens. And it's free on Ravelry. It has charts for the tops of the hands, which are the same for both mittens, and then charts for the palms, which are different. See, different. You can't really see. So what it is on the top, there is a Totoro with an umbrella and some raindrops. And then on the back, there are dust bunnies, and the thumb has a little dust bunny with an umbrella. I'm super excited. Oh my gosh. I will model these for you when they're finished because I super love them. And I would not be surprised if these were finished next week because I am really enjoying the knitting on them. The longest part was the cuff because it was 2x2 rib, so that was a slog, but I'm really enjoying the color work even though it has super long floats sometimes, all that. I am using US size 4, which is 3.5 millimeter needles for the mitts. My mom's sweater is on a US 7, which is 4.5 millimeters. Yes. And the socks are on US 1's 2.25 millimeter needles. And the yarn that I'm using for this is Knit Picks Stroll Sport. This is the Stream Heather colorway, and this is the Wave Heather colorway. I think it's perfect for Totoro mitts. I think these are going to be so awesome, and I am so in love with them. So I will probably wear them once before I give them to my sister, because whatever. They're so awesome. I plan to make a modification to the pattern. I don't know if I'll be successful. Amanda requested that I make her mittens that flip open, so I am going to attempt to do that. It's not how the pattern is written, but I will try. We will see. I have not yet decided if I feel ambitious enough to make them just flip-top mittens or also do fingers inside. Amanda, did you specify that was a requirement? Because I don't know. That sounds kind of like a lot. And also scary. We'll see how that goes. I'm really excited for those, though. I picked up my beekeeper's quilt. This show is going to be really short. I guess that's okay, because last week's show was really long. I picked up my beekeeper's quilt and I made some hex puffs. I'm going to save the best one for last. They're all pretty good. They're mostly out of ZK yarn. This one is not. This is from the socks that I made for Gabriel. The rest is, except for one, is ZK yarn. So here's one. I love this colorway. It looks like gingerbread houses. I don't make gingerbread houses or do anything with them, but I like this colorway because it reminds me of them. That's weird, right? Whatever. How about this reminds me of, this totally reminds me of hot chocolate with candy canes in it. Oh, I love that. I love that so much. This colorway is just gorgeous. Oh, I'm not sure what this yarn is. Oh, big hug. But I think it's maybe a silk or a Tencel mix because it's kind of shiny. You want to knit with me?
Yes.
Okay.
Whee, this is fun.
This is fun. So this is ZK yarn.
Oops.
This is
Nora. My hair.
Sake.
It's so pretty.
Your hair is so pretty. This is Noro sock yarn or lace yarn that I got from Anastasia at the CK. And I really like this colorway because it's just super fun. This is my favorite Hexapuff for the week. Okay, hold it high. Good job.
Hi.
This is...
That's your camera?
That is my camera. This is a Hexapuff made using the toes from the socks that I cut
Mommy.
Off. What I did was I picked up stitches, bless you, around the edge of the socks, of the toes, and then I knit on either toe. I knit with a few increases, and then I Kitchenered all the way around the center. So it's a little bit funny shaped, but all the ones that have been funny shaped so far work fine once they're sewn into the blanket, so I'm not worried about it. And also, that's kind of awesome. So I started a barn raising square blanket. This is using the yarn from the socks, the Nightingale socks that I just did. The green is a Yarn Well Spun Wind in the Willows colorway, and the black is Knit Picks Stroll in black. Stroll fingering weight. I decided when I made the square that I was going to do a black border on all of the squares so that I could sew them together or whatever using black and they would all be the same and it also kind of will look like stained glass. So this is yarn that I picked up from the ZK this year in the mini skein swap. It's pretty. I intend to use all of the yarns, all types of yarn, so not all weights, but all color types of yarn. Variegateds, tonals, semi-solids, striping. I did the math, and in order to make a blanket in a size that I would like, I need 210 squares. So now I'm at 2 of 210 squares. I am super excited about my new thing. Okay, so first, finished objects. No. First story. So last week, I did prize drawings, and that was very exciting. And I've heard back from all of the winners, and prizes have not gone out yet, except to one. But Renee sent me a message, and she said something like, "Yay, I'm glad I won, but I want to propose a trade. I would be willing to trade the bag, because you love it, for some spinning cuffs, because she's having trouble with the fiber getting in the way." And I was like, so I was in VKN. And sometimes when you're in VKNs, you check all the social media, because you do. Everybody in the VKN does it. So I was checking Ravelry, and I was in the VKN with Josh and Haley, and they were talking about something, and I was 100% so rude. I was like, oh my gosh, as soon as I opened it, and I finished reading, and they were like, what's going on? And I completely freaked out because I have a new thing. I have this awesome bag from Kitchen Counter Crafter. Oh my gosh, I love it so much. Okay, so first, here's the tag, Kitchen Counter Crafter. And I'm using it to hold the yarn, all these yarns, for my sister's mittens. So even though it's the small bag, it's the single shot, it's still pretty roomy. 150 grams plus the project fits snugly in the bag. It's not a lot of room, but it fits and it closes. And I love this bag. Oh, look at how cute that bag is. I'm so excited. So, two cuffs. That was the trade. Totally awesome. Awesome trade. And here they are. Here's one that's stripey. You might recognize this yarn. I had a lot from this. I have made a square for my blanket, my sock yarn blanket. There's a square in there. I have used it to make now a barn raising square. I've made a hexapuff using this yarn. I've made a cuff, and I have enough to probably make another barn raising square or another cuff, or I don't know. It was a really, really big leftover piece that I received in the swap. And then this is the other. This is, I believe this is Knit Picks Essentials in Grass. It is what I made the heel toe cuff for my brother's socks out of. And I had a lot of this leftover. So these are the two. They have different, the cuffs are the same. They have slightly different stitch counts because I wanted to, I wasn't sure which was going to fit better. So Renee, when you get them, if one fits really well and one doesn't fit well, just let me know which one fits really well and I will make you another in that same stitch count. I just wasn't sure what to do sizing wise. So there's that. And then they both have similar but different patterning for the pocket part. And I will be sending these off. My intent is to send these this afternoon after I finish recording and Gabriel gets home from school, which is soon. So these will be out into the world before this podcast goes up. Yay! And I think I knit these on US 2 2.75 millimeter, and I used a crochet hook for the cuff portions. You can do this part not in crocheting, but it is, in my experience, easier to just crochet the top part and faster. The one that I have, my distaff, which is not around. Oh, yes, it is. It's right here. Mine is knit because a friend made it for me. But, I find crocheting much faster and still very attractive. And I have a new bag and I love it so much. Oh, I'm so excited to have this bag. It's so cute. It is so cute and so perfect for this time of year, and really any time of the year, because fall is my favorite time of the year. And look at how cute it is with the little fox and the star. The fox and the star are my favorite. I mean, the leaf and the acorns, the leaves and the acorns, because there's two different styles of leaves. Very cute. But the fox and the star, especially the fox and the little blue bubble. Okay, I'm not going to talk about that bag for 8,000 years because I've already shown it on the podcast a bajillion times. But it's so awesome. I have been reading a decent amount this week. I finished Songs of Love and Death, and I have to agree, I think I told you last week that Steve read the book a long time ago, or sometime in the podcasting history of this book. I think I told you that Steve read it, and he said he did not enjoy some of the stories at the end. I kind of agree. There are some stories that at the end that I'm like, okay. Like, they weren't bad, I just didn't enjoy them. But overall, very good book. I picked up on a whim last week. Oh, I'm sad. I'm pretty sure I've told you that Wednesdays were family story time at the library for my son's school, and last week was the last week of that. So that's sad. For family reading time, because it's for school-aged kids, they had a librarian who took preschool kids so that families could interact and not have to worry about managing preschool kids. Because if you have children or have been around children, you know that small children take a lot of management. It can be difficult to get them to sit for periods of time in discussions that they don't necessarily understand, which was fine. But Mara is kind of needy. So Steve and I switched off who was in the room with her, and it was usually me because it was just easier that way. She's much more into hanging out with me than with him, just because I don't know why. So for the first 5 weeks, one of us was always in there with her. And the last week, she seemed really, really excited about going with the librarian. And I said, so, because the week before, Mara was actually trying to shoo me off to work. I left early because I had work every day except one of those Wednesdays. So she tried to shoo me off early, and I was like, it's not time for work. So this week I decided that I would just not sit in the room, but instead of staying in the room with with everybody else, I would sit right outside the room that she was in. That way, in case she started freaking out or something, which she did in the past, which is why we always sat there. The second week, neither of us went in with her, and the librarian actually had to come get me because Mara was like, ah, what's going on? And kept trying to leave the room and stuff. And there was only one librarian and two children. So that's why I ended up sitting with her a lot. Anyway, week six, I decided that since Mara did not seem concerned about where I was, that I would just sit outside of the area. Mara did not make a fuss. She stayed in there the entire 45 minutes by herself. So as soon as I was like, okay, well, I'm going to be sitting outside, I immediately went and grabbed the two books, this being one of them. And then I proceeded to read that much and haven't read since then. Read and knit at the same time. So if I had just been reading, I would be farther, but it takes a little bit longer to read and knit because I don't immediately drop my hands to turn the page when I'm knitting. I usually finish whatever my brain is doing at that moment and then turn the page. Anyway, this is Between the Devil and the Deep Blue Sea by April Genevieve Tuklock. It'll be in show notes. I don't actually know what it's about. I totally picked it up because of the cover. It's a young adult book. All of these nominees are young adult. And so far it's about a girl who's living in a house with her brother. They're 17. Their parents have run away to Europe for artist stuff. They live in a small town, so nobody's like calling CPS on them. They live in a old house. They're also old money, but the money's kind of running out now. And all of the money that their parents left them before they went to Europe is pretty much gone. So they have a guest house on their property, which they're renting out to another young person, 17, supposed to stay with his uncle in town, but doesn't want to. I don't know if I believe that, but I'm not very far into the story, so I'm not sure what's going on. It's pretty interesting. I'm enjoying it I was enjoying it so far, and then I came home and started reading the books that I had been reading instead of reading this one because they were due back to the library sooner. I like it so far, I think. I will let you know as I continue reading it, maybe not this coming week because I do have several books that need to go back to the library this week that I should probably read. And I don't know if I can renew them. But I'll let you know what I think about that one. I like it so far. It was definitely not a bad impulse pickup. One of the books that is due back this week that I picked up yesterday is Princess of the Silver Woods by Jessica Day George. It is the third book from the Princess. I think it's just a trilogy. This seems like this is going to be the final piece in the story. The first one was Princess of the Midnight Ball, and the second was Princess of Glass. So I picked it up yesterday, and I am almost finished with it because, well, I mean, first of all, the prince is huge. And second of all, I'm really, really enjoying this book. So much more than I liked the second one. Probably on par to how much I liked the first one. It's very interesting. I like it so much. It's kind of a Little Red Riding Hood-esque. I just looked at the back of this book and it says for one of the reviews, fans of fairy tale retellings like Robin McKinley's Beauty or Gail Carson Levine's Ella Enchanted will enjoy the story. Ella Enchanted is my favorite Cinderella retelling. Not the movie. The movie, but the book, oh, I love it so much. Anyway, I'm really enjoying this book. I will probably finish it today or tomorrow, depending on if I read or not today. We'll see. I have to clean. I don't wanna. Necessary evil of being a grown up and junk. And I'm also listening to Dorothy Must Die, which I don't remember who that's by. It will be in the show notes. My library didn't have Dorothy Must Die on hard copy. They only had audiobooks, so I decided I'd get it. And I only listen to it in my car when I'm going to work or on break from work. Josh from Sword of a Knitter, he recommended it to me. And he is much more into it than I am because he read the Oz books and I did not. I want to eventually, but I just haven't. So he really, really liked it because he already knew the characters. So he had this attachment to the stories that I don't have. But for someone who doesn't really know the story, I mean, I've seen The Wizard of Oz, but that was a really, really long time ago. A really long time ago. Like elementary school. Long time ago. So I don't really remember it. I vaguely remember the second Wizard of Oz movie. Very strange. But I don't really remember the story or the characters. I'm not really attached to it. That said, it's a pretty interesting retelling from what I can tell, except it's very angsty. And you know I don't mind angsty. You know I'm all about young adult books. But this one's really angsty. It's kind of reminds me of Harry Potter, like, 6 and 7. It's getting better. I'm about halfway through. And it's getting a little less whiny and a little more interesting. If you like the Wizard of Oz stories, if you're familiar with them and you know the characters, I would recommend it. If you don't really know it and you're not attached to the characters, I would still say it's decent. I would probably enjoy it more if I was reading it. I think that's a large problem with the book is the narrator is kind of whiny. And I could gloss over that if I was reading it in from paper, but there's no way to get around the whininess when you're listening to it. So I don't know. I'm kind of mixed on this book so far, but again, I'm only about halfway through it. I have two podcast recommendations for you this week. Knit All the Things with Kara. I'm sure you've heard about that from everybody if you listen to pretty much any other podcast. She's super cute. She's in Wales. She's from England. She is in university. And she is 20, I believe. So adorable. And pretty prolific knitting for a university student, especially. She talks about things related to her major, and in one of her episodes, I binge watched all 5 of them yesterday. So I don't remember which episode. She shows her view out the window from her flat. I think that was episode 4. And episode 5 is on a different location because she's visiting her boyfriend. Yeah, very enjoyable, very conversational. Obviously, adorable accent if you live in the U.S. because everything U.K. is adorable. And the other is a podcast that I am not sure if I mentioned before. I have a sticky note in my notebook that I write down notes for myself to talk about later. If it's something that I'm going to talk about the next week, I just turn the page and write that on the next week. But I found this one on the sticky note in my notebook, and I feel like I should have talked about it because I've been watching for a while and been all caught up for a long time, but maybe not, and I would much rather just say it. So anyway, it is The Knitting Room with Ellie, and she's cute. Everybody is so cute. I love podcasters. I think most of them are adorable. She knits a lot of socks and a lot of tams. For a while there, she was trying to figure out what she wanted to do with her sock yarn scraps. She wanted to make a something, but she tried several things and they weren't right for her. And I'm pretty sure she has finally settled on the linen stitch scarf. What is that called? You guys know what I'm talking about? Steve from Dramatic Knits made one. I'm pretty sure that's what she has settled on. And the way, I could be wrong. I could be confused on that being what she settled on. But the way that she's doing it, I do know this is correct, is she's trading off, for whatever project she's doing, she's trading off a solid and or a semi-solid and a variegated. And she pulls the solid color from the variegated color. So if her solid, well, let's say she starts with a solid green, then the variegated she uses would have to have green in it. And then the next solid color would be a different color from the variegated. So say orange, and then solid orange, and then a variegated with orange in it, and then a blue because the variegated had blue in it, something like that. Very interesting. I'm really excited to see how that goes. I hope you made something fantastic with your sticks and string, and I will see you next week. Bye! See you reaching it. You did it.